A very good evening to everyone gathered here. It's a glad welcome we bring to you this evening, filled with the desires, hopes, and dreams we all share. It is said that a teacher should inspire a child to achieve academic success, but it is the parent who inspires the child to use that success in a way that influences positive change in the world. Dear parents, we appreciate each one of you for taking time off your busy schedules to join us today for this parent-teacher meeting. Prayer is the opening of the heart to God as to a friend. Let us begin this meeting by invoking God's blessing through a prayer song.
Ye mat kaho khuda se meri mushkilein badi hain. Ye mat kaho khuda se meri mushkilein badi hain. मुश्किलों से कह दो मेरा खुदा बड़ा है. आती है आंधियां तो कर उनका खैर मकदम. आती है आंधियां तो कर उनका खैर मकदम. तूफान से ही तो लड़ने खुदा ने तुझे गढ़ा है. ये मत कहो खुदा से मेरी मुश्किलें बड़ी हैं. ये मुश्किलों से कह दो मेरा खुदा बड़ा है. मेरा खुदा बड़ा है. मेरा खुदा बड़ा है. अग्नि में तप के सोना है और भी निखरता. अग्नि में तप के सोना है और भी निखरता. दुर्गम को पार करके हिमालय कोई चढ़ा है. लाएगी रंग मेहनत आखिर तुम्हारी एक दिन. लाएगी रंग मेहनत आखिर तुम्हारी एक दिन. होगा विशाल तरुवल वो बीज जो पड़ा है. ये मत कहो खुदा से मेरी मुश्किलें बड़ी. ये मुश्किलों से कह दो मेरा खुदा बड़ा है. मेरा खुदा बड़ा है. मेरा खुदा बड़ा है. सर्वशक्तियों से जब साथ है हमारे. वो सर्वशक्तियों से जब साथ है हमारे. हर काम उसके रहते हर दिस हुआ पड़ा है. कभी हार ना हिम्मत का कदम बढ़ाओ. कभी हार ना हिम्मत का कदम बढ़ाओ. हजारों कदम बढ़ाने वो सामने खड़ा है. ये मत कहो खुदा से मेरी मुश्किलें बड़ी. ये मुश्किलों से कह दो मेरा खुदा बड़ा है. ये मुश्किलों से कह दो मेरा खुदा.
Thank you, ma'am, for leading us in prayer. As fair as the breeze, as wondrous as the sea, enchanting to the heart, a warm welcome would be. I now request Ms. Jansi to welcome the gathering and introduce the resource person for today.
Good evening, everyone. I extend my warm greetings to the most respected principal, our highly esteemed guests, ladies and gentlemen. I, Jansi Sikwera, feel privileged to welcome you to this meeting. First, I would like to welcome the eminent personality, Dr. Shalini Ayyappa, the Assistant Professor and Head of Department of Psychology at St. Aloysius College, Mangaluru. Dr. Shalini completed her doctorate in psychology with a special focus on adolescent psychology in 2015 under Mangalore University. She has been conducting many workshops seminars, lectures, All India Radio Talks on various psychology-related topics for the past 10 years, which has benefited many students, parents, and teachers. She is a trustee of Prajna Counseling Center since 2005, member of American Psychological Association, and the life member of Indian School Psychology Association. Dr. Shalini has the credit of presenting innumerable research papers in national and international level journals. She is an ongoing learner and continues to research in her field. We are truly blessed to have Dr. Shalini Ayyappa as the resource person for our parent teachers meeting today. A hearty welcome to you, ma'am. I would like to welcome our dear principal, Reverend Father Melvin Lobo SJ, who is an efficient leader and guides the students towards academic excellence through compassion, dedication, and selfless service. We are highly fortunate to have him as our principal. Father, you are warmly welcome to this meeting.
Thank you.
We have among us our vice principal, Ms. Laurel D'Souza, who is always a supporting hand in all our endeavors. I welcome you, ma'am, to this session.
Thank you, ma'am.
I also welcome the faculty members who are present for this meeting. I would like to welcome the highly esteemed parents who have kindly accepted our invitation to this meeting. We sincerely appreciate your cooperation in sparing your time despite your busy schedule and honoring this invitation. We welcome you all and appreciate unreserved love for this institution. We are looking forward to working with all the parents and making this year an exciting and a successful one. Once again, I extend a warm welcome to all.
Thank you, ma'am. A warm welcome to you too. A good leader can inspire hope, ignite the imagination, and instill a love of learning. I request our principal, Reverend Father Melvin Anil Lobo SJ, to enlighten us with his message.
Good evening to all the parents. Good evening to the resource persons, all the teachers. First of all, I would like to thank all the parents who are present in this meeting. You have kept aside all your works. Some of you may have informed your officers and taken a time out and are present for this meeting. I would like to thank all of you for being present for this meeting and for your cooperation at this moment. Without much delay, I would like to begin straight away with the small presentation that I have before the resource person begins her presentation. First of all, my dear parents, we are in a difficult situation. Our context is one of a pandemic. The COVID-19 struck us last year, and we are going through that. Already we had two waves, and the third one is looks like it is expected. So we do not know how it is going to be. However, we are trying our best to continue with the learning, and the learning has been on online mode. It has been a very challenging time for all of you, for our students, teachers, as well as for the management. It has been a challenging time for all. And yet we know that learning has to continue, life has to continue, and we are trying our best. As long as physical classes are not available, we need to adapt ourselves. So that is what we have been trying to do. The other context that we are in is we already have national educational policy. We have been already introduced to this. We had one session with all the parents, and but I would like to recapture here two or three points. One thing is the academic structure. You know already that 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4. What is this 5 plus 3? 5 is the foundational years, pre-primary. pre-KG, KG1, KG2, class 1 and class 2 includes the foundational years. Preparatory 3 years, that is class 3 to 5. Middle school 3 years, class 6 to 8. Secondary 4 years, class 9 to 12. Earlier it was class 10 plus 2, 10 years of basic education and 2 years of preparation for university education. Pre-KG has been already introduced in our school. Class 11 and 12, we already obtained permission this year and we will be beginning the coming academic year, the class 11. Skill courses are something that is introduced in the NEP. Slowly, we will be putting a structure and we will be also introducing these skill courses in our school. 6 to 8, it is only 12 hours, which is not like, no, they need not get an approval from the board. But class 9 to 12, there is a board exam for that, but it is in of a different scale. So, but it needs approval from the board. So, and it is also sort of encouraged that we start these innovative pedagogies to be introduced. As you know, CBSE comes out or has come out with a lot of innovative pedagogies. These have been already integrated in national education policy, like experiential learning, competency-based learning, art integration, sports integration, etc. The third context is we are in the 500th anniversary of the founder. Founder is none other than Saint Ignatius of Loyola, he is remembered in the history, as you know, all of us know about him. He is known for counter-reformation, and the members of the society which he began, that is Society of Jesus, the Jesuits, well known in the world, started the modern education, and they were known as the schoolmasters of Europe, the members of the Society of Jesus. The context is 1521, battle in Pamplona, and Ignatius getting wounded, and after that what followed is the conversion. This year we are celebrating the Ignatian year. It has been dedicated because it is 500th year since he was wounded and converted. The time to reflect on transforming education provided by the organization. Just to give a glimpse of how many education institutions this organization has got. World over, there are 3,897 in 96 countries. There are 29,28,806 students. In India, we have 363 education and institutions, 11,525 teachers, students, 3,34,538. And among those 3,34,538, Gonzaga students are also there. So what we are going to reflect is one man's transforming experience having an impact on the world. Though 500 years are over, yet this organization has stood the test of time. And it has not only stood the test of time, but also continuing to give service which is most relevant to today's world. So something that we need to reflect on. The second aspect that I would like to focus on today is that we need to continue with the learning in spite of the challenging time. We know that it is very challenging because of the pandemic. All of us are facing it. And yet, how we can combine learning at the same time well-being. There are a few things which are I have taken out from CBSE and my own here. I just want to present it to you, some 10 things that we can do. One thing is creating a safe and engaging environment. Now the school, the house, home is becoming the school. So how can we make it safe and engaging environment? Maybe to have certain amount of schedule for our children from the rising till the going to bed. Some scheduling, not so much of timetable, but scheduling of different things. So that is very important. Second is creating a positive learning environment. How do we create the positive? First of all, the house members cooperating when there are classes, and at the same time, maybe when the child is studying, can we devote some time of say 1.5 hours for our children and help the child to learn? Thirdly, use of positive discipline, like motivating the child, reasoning out, discussion, and all this. Instead of shouting or maybe in a way using some negative disciplining aspects. Talk and have fun with the children. That is also important because children are disconnected from their peers, their friends. So to have little more of talk, sitting with the children, have fun with them. Having realistic expectation from the child. Of course, when children were coming to the school, you could expect a lot from them. But now with the change of lot of things, perhaps you need to be a little more understanding, but at the same time to get the things done. Say, for example, the child may not sit for 1.5 hour of study. At least if the child is sitting for, say, about 1 hour, to accept and help to motivate the child to study well and do well. Take care of health, healthy food, sleep, routines, and exercise. These three things are very important. Healthy food, sleep routines, and exercise. For yourself and also for your child. We encourage these things so that your health is also taken care. Be aware of the behavioral changes in your ward. Maybe the children are small, may not be so much behavioral changes, but yet to take care of them. Children learn from children. If you have got elder sibling, the elder sibling can teach the younger one, be with the child and help him or her to learn. Parents are partners with teachers. Partners here mean that you two are in a way sharing the responsibility of the teachers, and you can connect with the teachers and help your ward in terms of learning. So you are partners, we will help you, and you also can connect with us. For working parents, maybe it is a little more work in terms of going back and maybe to get to know what exactly is happening, if the elder sibling is there, from the elder sibling, or maybe the grandparents being there, or maybe some relatives at home. So to get to know from them, and at the same time what is there placed in Microsoft team or from the teachers, and following up with the students, with the awards. The third thing that I would like to highlight is the curriculum, which is known to you, but I just want to highlight few things. One thing is the CBSE highlights this year's curriculum as focused on holistic development students. There are three important things that they want to highlight this year. First of all, application of knowledge and skills in real life or problem solving scenarios. So 30% has been has to be there in terms of application based. So this is one aspect. Promoting creative and critical thinking. This is one aspect of the 21st century skills. There are learning skills, there are literacy skills, there are life skills. Among the learning skills, these two are quite very important. So we develop these, we wish to develop these skills. Thirdly, integrating innovation in pedagogy. Already I told you this aspect. Already our teachers have been trained in learning outcomes and the competency-based teaching. Art integration has been already introduced last year, which will continue. Experiential learning has been also introduced to the teachers, and it will be introduced also to the students. So in that perspective, I just would like to make some note here, important points. Encourage your ward to be attentive and actively participate during the online classes. So that is an important aspect. Students must keep a notebook and textbook for all the classes. Let that notebook and textbook, let it be there side by side. Students must study on a daily basis for about an hour and a half. So 3 to 5 students, we expect that some amount of study is put in by the students. The activities, assignments, and notebooks should be submitted on time. This is important because part of the internals. Students should practice mathematics sums on a daily basis. See, this is an interesting thing, but this needs to be done in a regular way. Need monitoring of both online classes as well as their study. We request you to do so, at least in terms of their study. During language classes, students should try to speak in the same language. speaking in the same language is very much required, especially like when they have Hindi classes or Kannada classes. We encourage the students to speak in those languages. Coming to the assessment, as you know, the assessment for class 3rd to 5 is based on term-wise system. We have two terms. Term 1 is from June to October end, and then we have second term from November to April. So term 1 total 50 marks, 40 marks for term exam and 10 marks for internal, so also the term 2. Internals, 5 marks notebooks, 5 marks PT, 5 marks subject enrichment. This will be reduced to out of 10. We expect the students to be honest during the exams because of the online. Most of the students are online, but we want to make that point as well. Student must send the images of the answer script in PDF format only. Try to do this because that will be helpful for us. Students must prepare well for the exams. Students must present well the subject enrichment activities, something that has been informed. Those activities need to be presented well. Coming to second aspect of the curriculum, co-scholastic area. As you know, we have the co-curricular areas like art education, health and physical education, SUPW. It has been there earlier and this will continue. We also from the school side give to the students computer education, general knowledge. Value education temporarily kept on hold. We will come back to that as soon as the normal classes begin. Then music. Normal means physical classes. In terms of co-curricular activities, besides co-scholastic areas, we have co-curricular activities for the students. We have a number of activities like projects, Nutrilite project we already completed June month, Go Green project in the month of July. We also have British Council project. It will be done class-wise. When the 3rd to 5th standard term comes, we will inform you. And it is to develop internationalism and global outlook among the children. Academic weeks. We have 5 academic weeks spread over the whole year. Science week, we have already completed. Hindi Saptaha, Kannada week, Social Science week, Maths week. We also have number of academic days, national days, institutional days, religious feasts, international days. So all these will be informed to you, as well as the children will be informed, and a certain way of celebrating them and observing them will be done. We will not be holding ECA classes, clubs and association this year because of the pandemic. They'll be kept on hold, but the above activities will be conducted. With regard to co-scholastic as well as co-curricular activities, few points I would like to bring it to your knowledge. One is co-curricular activities are organized for the holistic development of students. Encourage your ward to participate in the various activities organized by the school. That's an important thing. Encourage your children. Students should participate in the activities using their own creative ideas as far as possible. So you may help them, but let them try to do as far as possible. School provides platform for students to exhibit their talents in various areas. Encourage maximum participation. All participants are provided with e-certificate. We will all give e-certificates, and at the same time, at the end of the year, we will be giving this year a consolidated certificate where all the activities of this year conducted by the school will be documented, and the certificate will be given to all the students. Inform class teacher if won any prizes in competition organized outside the school. The last slide that I have, that is fourth aspect, behavioral aspect. As you know, character formation is an important aspect. Though the class 3 to 5, we do not have many issues, but yet formation is part of the school education. So I would like to bring to your knowledge few things here which are important. Students should join the online class 5 minutes before the class starts. Students need to inform class teacher if they are unable to join the class. Should be neatly dressed and away from all other distractions. We have 3 platforms for class as well as communication. One is school app, official communication from the school or principal will be done through the school app, not through the WhatsApp group. So check the school app regularly, every day, at least once you open and see what new thing has come. Second, class WhatsApp group, only reminders will be sent through this, and no kind of classroom work will be given here. No communication or follow-up on school work. Third is the Microsoft Teams. It's an online classroom, and all information regarding classes, notes, activities done and followed up here. Of course, if the classes or physical classes were there, we would not have had Microsoft Teams. The next aspect is parents are requested not to interrupt during the classes, even if they sit beside the ward. If need be, call separately and inform, because that will disturb all the parents and students who are sitting there, as well as the teacher. It will disturb the teacher to conduct smoothly the class. Students are expected to be present for all the classes. Any absence should be informed to the teacher in advance. So dear parents, these are few things as guidelines for all of you, and it will help us also get maximum cooperation from your side, so also we can give our best to your students. So with this note, I would like to thank all of you once again for being present for this session, and I'm sure the resource persons will definitely enlighten you how you could guide your children. So once again, thanks to all of you, thanks to the resource person and all the staff members present here. Thank you and wish you all the best.
Thank you, Father, for enlightening us through your message. We are delighted to have Mangal, Dr. Shalini Iyer, who is a parent and teacher herself, to share us with her knowledge and expertise. Dear parents, kindly note that the chat box will be enabled for your queries 15 minutes before the winding up of the input session. I now request Dr. Shalini Iyappa to take over the session. Over to you, ma'am.
A very good evening to all. Respected Principal Reverend Father Melvin Lobo SJ, the teachers of St. Aloysius Gonzaga School, and the dear parents. When Father Melvin told me that I have to address the parents of children who belong to different age groups, it was like, for me, it was like going back as to what I did with my child, and it just felt like it's so long ago. I mean, within just no time, they just kind of grow up. Fortunately, going back the memory lane has not been painful or regretful, because I knew that there were certain things that I needed to do at that age, and I did it. Because there is no turning back of years. We can't give back their childhood. It comes only once. So for me, I think addressing a group of parents who have children of different age groups has been a kind of a wonderful experience. And I'm sure all of you want to be great parents. You kind of want to live in just a moment. I will just share the screen with you all. Of course, every parent kind of wants to be a great parent. Nothing wrong in that. But do you also want to live in a home where discipline becomes unnecessary? Well, I think then the secret is you need to create a closer connection with your child. This is the right time. You will have to make connecting with your child the highest priority. That should be your priority. And let me tell you, the moment you connect with your child, you will be able to take them or maybe go along with them even during their adolescent years, the teens, until they turn 25. It can be a beautiful experience, and all that you need to do is you just need to connect with them. Parenting is all about connection, and it's 80% of connection and just about 20% of guidance. That leaves you with a lot of peace too. So how do you do this? How do you connect with your child? There are only two things. One, it is you need to have a very thoughtful kind of an attention. And the second is look at things from the child's point of view. That's beautiful when you look at things from the child's point of view. You have left behind that years ago, yes. You just put yourself in your child's shoes and see how does the child feel at this point. When the child comes back home and says that, I don't have any friends in school. Now, I see that a lot of parents say, oh, it's all a part of growing up. You can make friends. You can do this. You can do that. I think you just need to stop and think and connect with the child and see, how does it feel not to have friends? So what is the reason? So these are the only two things that parents need to do if you want to connect with your child. And the minute you connect, most of your problems are sorted out. Thoughtful attention and looking at things from the child's perspective. Yes, of course, it takes a lot of effort, a lot of energy. And I think it is to be fully present with your child, because attention is equal to love. Every time you pay attention to what the child is doing or saying, and you're with the child there, you're fully with your child there. You don't have to say, I love you, but then that is communicated to the child. So every moment that you spend with the child, this is the message that you're communicating. And with this message comes the closer connection. It does take a lot of energy, a lot of effort, but I think it's worth investing your energy and effort in your child if you want to leave behind beautiful memories for their future. And like I said, when I went down the memory lane, it just felt like, oh my God, how did this happen? Just the other day, I kind of enrolled my child in the first grade. And the same feeling you two will have now. I'm sure your words are in the third, fourth, and the fifth grade. And your child is already becoming has become a full-fledged elementary school student. You are busy with your life, keeping a busy home together, and there your child is shaping into a person that he or she will become. So the tween years is just around the corner. I think it's important for you to take advantage of these years. Why I say take advantage of these years is, this is a period which is a very calm period. The children are very sweet children. They'll simply listen to what you say. What Dada and Mama says is right. They are actually internalizing your values. They are taking in your messages. They're very reasonable, very adjusting, very accommodating. I think this is the right time for you to build a very close relationship with your children. And what's important is you need to make them emotionally intelligent. You need to equip them with, I would say, terrific self-management skills. And that's very much required in this world today. And how do you do that? I would call it peaceful parenting. Because there's no such thing as perfect parenting. We are doing the best we can with the resources we have, what is available in this moment. So I would like to call it as peaceful parenting. So what is this peaceful parenting? Peaceful parenting is all about, all you need to do is just role model what you want your children, what do you want to see in your children. Again, it takes a lot of energy, it takes a lot of effort. Becoming parents is not hard, but parenting is hard. Because at every step, we need to stop and think. Because there is a child who is watching you. There's a child who is listening to you. There's a child who is creating what the world is like in its mind. So we need to role model what we want to see in our children. It's hard, but it's worth it. And I think one of the first parenting responsibility is about regulating our own emotions. Now, why I kind of want to focus on this is today we live in a very pressurized world where in most homes, both parents are working. We have moved from the joint families to nuclear families. And we also see more and more of more than intact families, it's more of non-intact families. I think it's very important that we learn to manage our emotions because our children are watching us. And their emotions, how they regulate, how they express, is influenced by the way we deal with our emotions. That means we need to stay calm to settle the storm. This is one of the first parenting responsibilities. So the question that you need to ask is, when I get upset, what is it that I do? How do I react? Because there is my child who's watching me. Do you escalate the situation? Or do you allow yourself to kind of calm down? If you escalate the situation, what the child feels is unsafe, and children also tend to get very stubborn because they see you being stubborn or they see us being stubborn. If you stay calm to settle the storm, you will open that space for meaningful communication. See, they are learning this. It's okay for me to get angry, but how I deal with my anger is very important. So do I throw things and show my anger? Or I just kind of wait to calm down and then talk to the person concerned. It could be your partner. It could be the child who has upset you about something. So do you just kind of stay calm, allow yourself to manage your emotions first and then make space for a meaningful communication or conversation? This is one of the first responsibilities of parenting. The second responsibility is, because I'm talking about connecting with your child. So you want to connect with your child, then it's important that we also regulate our emotions. Otherwise, dadas and mamas appear like monsters to them. The second thing is, can we connect before we correct? You know, we are so used to, or probably we are used to it because probably that's what our parents did. Can we just connect with them before we correct? Now, why should or why would your child connect or cooperate with you? It's basically because they connect with you. I'm not saying that you should not set limits or you allow them to do what they want to do. You need to set limits, but when you set limits, also make sure that you empathize at the same time. Understand that when she or he is acting out or throwing a tantrum, why they do it is because they feel disconnected. They just want to connect with you. I feel so overwhelmed. I don't know how to manage my emotions. I'm getting irritated. I'm getting frustrated. I'm getting angry. I don't know what to do. Now, you're also teaching them how to regulate their emotions when you connect. So all you need to do is just connect. How? If you can just tell the child, come, let's see how we can do it. Instead of saying, don't do that. Or you've not done it rightly or not done it correctly. I think if you can just tell the child, come, let's sit down. Come, let's see how we can do it. You're connecting with the child. The correction will come automatically there. The minute you connect with the child, you're not dismissing his feelings. You're not dismissing the child's feelings. It's okay for you to be frustrated. It's okay for you to be angry. It's okay for you to be irritated. So the minute I connect, the child is also able to calm down and you can have a dialogue with the child. See, this dialogue should not be something that you need to use in your communication when the child comes into the adolescent stage. That will never happen. A dialogue is something that you have to begin right from the time that you've started communicating with your child. And if you have not, now maybe you have to make a conscious effort to connect with the child through a dialogue. Now, this is something that I do come across in many schools with many children. But somehow this is something that has not been addressed. And bullying is, you know, the middle childhood period is the period that your children are in. This is the prime time for bullying. So I'm not talking about how not, what to do with the bully. I'm talking about how not to turn your children into a bully. Because we don't want bullies. So how do we make sure that our children don't turn into bullies? Or it could also be where our children are not victims of bullies. Even if they are victims of bullies, they assert themselves and they handle the situation where the impact is not negative. That again reflects on the home front. Is the parent modeling compassionate behavior? Is the child exposed to compassionate and respectful relationships back home? Because if you want to bully proof your child, then it's important that these children grow up in loving, respectful relationships than relationships where there is a lot of use of power and force. So power and force is used to kind of control them. So any discipline methods that uses power over the child seems to use the same power over others in school. I remember this child who was bullied by her classmate, I think when she was in the second grade. And the child had just gotten into a new school. And the child was kind of cute, and the other child in the class kind of felt very threatened. Maybe because the attention was kind of being divided there. And because of this jealousy, the child who was already there in that school for a longer period started bullying this newcomer. And of course, the school did nothing about it because the other child who was a victim of the bully told me that, no, I didn't want my parents to interfere because, you know, then they would have this whole drama of calling us and asking us to be friends. And, you know, they wouldn't really deal with it in a way where the other person also understands. And the victim of the bully tells me that I knew why she was doing that because I got to know that. You know, her mother used to beat her and use a lot of such means of disciplining her, and she was just taking it out on me here in school. And the victim, well, asserted herself because she came from a family where, home where there was a lot of stability, and disciplining was not done through these kind of punishments. So at one point, the child stood up and said that, I don't want to be called that. Call me by my name. So every time she asserted herself, the girl who was bullying realized that it wouldn't work. But the sad part is that most of the schools don't take cognizance of this. So if we want to make sure that our children do not resort to these things and don't bully others, you don't want them to become bullies, then it's important that we expose them to compassionate, respectful relationships. We need to understand that children misbehave when they feel bad about themselves and they are disconnected from us. Let's always keep that in mind. Their misbehavior is because they feel disconnected from us. And when they misbehave, generally what parents do is they give them a beating. They spank them. Now, when you spank, what happens? You're actually aggravating that bad feeling. Or child is already feeling bad. You're making it worse. And at the same time, you're also lowering the self-esteem of the child. Because for any child to be successful in life, the child should have good self-esteem. So if the child is constantly beaten, self-esteem gets affected. And at the same time, when you spank, you're also conveying the message to the child that people who love you can also hurt you. And what are the long-term implications of this? Either they become submissive and weak in violent relationships. They do nothing, but they take it. Or maybe they may also go into depression, or as adults, they may become very violent. Instead, I think what's important here is when children misbehave again, it's important for us to reason out with them. That means, again, get down to their level, talk and listen to them. Why they misbehave is because they have not learned to manage their emotions. So parents have to learn to regulate their own emotions, because if the priority is to strengthen your connection with your child, then one is to regulate your emotions. The second is accept the child and start the connection by reaffirming the connection. Get down to their level. If it's like the child has pushed the brother and maybe the brother had a fall, then what you could do to connect is, you want your brother to move, so you pushed him. Pushing hurts. Tell your brother, move please. Put your hand around your shoulder. Say that you're upset right now. It makes a huge difference. See, even when you enforce rules, make sure that you also acknowledge the child's perspective. Because when they feel understood, they also accept your limits. It's like if the child wants to play longer, but you want to say that it's enough. You wish that you could play longer, but now it's bedtime. And I know that it makes you sad. So you've acknowledged their feelings. You've put yourself in their shoes and you have seen what it feels like. Yes, you and I also at that age would have felt the same. The play should kind of go on and on. The play time should go on and on. The same thing the children also feel. So the minute you say, I know that makes you sad, you're actually acknowledging their feelings. When you acknowledge their feelings, they will comply to your limits. And sometimes children can also sometimes question certain things that you do. And it's important for you not to take offense. I remember my daughter when I don't remember the situation, what exactly led to it, but I think I'd given her my peace of mind. And then what she did was she drew a picture of me, and the picture of me was in the balcony. It's like she has put me out, and she showed me the picture, and I said, who is this? And she said, it's you. I said, where have you put me? And she said, I put you in the balcony. And I said, why? And then she says, no, I did not like the way you reacted. She said, I did not like the way you reacted. I said, okay, then I think you can also draw your dada's picture. And she said, no, he understands. So then I got into a conversation with her. I said, what is it that you did not like about what I said? So they started connecting. This connection continued for a while. I explained to her. Then I said, yes, if this is what you did not like about what I said, I'm sorry. I acknowledged her feelings too, and we connected. See, this is important. If you find that your child is defiant, keep in mind that the problem is a relationship problem. Now, this is something that can happen from time to time. At such times, all you need to do is you just have to stop and think as to how do I strengthen this relationship. Don't focus on how to make the child mind about this. It's not about that. It's about how do I now strengthen this connection? How do I strengthen this relationship? Because if the child is defiant, then it's a relationship problem. Now, in case your focus is on how to get the child to mind, then you're turning that situation into a power struggle. And I think the conflict is just going to deepen further. All you need to do is, okay, why is the child being defiant? I told you, any misbehavior is when they feel disconnected. All you need to do is just connect with them. And for you to connect, it's important that you don't lose your patience and temper, but then you have to operate from a space where you stay calm. That's very important. See, many a times we think that consequences will teach them a lesson. But if you are involved in creating that consequence, definitely not. But if the consequences follows their actions, then of course it's a great learning experience for them. But again, we find that many a times parents kind of engineer the consequences. As in, like, when I say consequences here, I'm talking about punishment. Because if you want your kids to do the right things, then you need to raise them without punishment. Because punishment only operates from the space of fear, not compassion. And all you need to do there is just, you need to listen, you need to talk to help them to manage their emotions. Because ultimately we want to teach our children wherein they feel that they want to do the right thing. And let me tell you, there is a frontal cortex in the brain. This is the area of the brain which understands the consequences of one's actions, and it takes about 25 years to develop. I think if we want them to control their behavior, then it is through talking and listening to what? About their feelings, about the values, about the decisions. So you will help the wiring in the frontal cortex when you talk and you listen. It is not through punishment. Because when you give them punishment, it's always about how do I avoid this? So they slowly learn to lie. They don't know the reason behind it, so they don't reason it out. So again, you bring in a dialogue here. Reason it out with the child. And that's exactly what happens when you talk and listen to them. And today with technology, it's not even about television, but it's technology today. Everybody has a phone, so even a little child is gifted a phone today. That they spend a lot of time with technology, given the online classes. Apart from that, I think it's important that you keep the bedtime boring. Bedtime should be boring for them because they need to slow down. They need to go into that sleep ritual because it takes a while. And it's important for these children to sleep for about 9 to 10 hours, because that's the time, this is again a growing period. Their growth hormones are released when they are fast asleep. Whatever information that they are taking in gets cemented when they are sleeping, especially when they are dreaming. A lot of repair in the body happens during their sleep. But what happens is when you do not keep the bedtime boring, but you excite them with, music and loud talking, then it becomes difficult for the children to fall asleep because then they get excited. That's why I say keep the bedtime boring. And they have to follow the sleep ritual. It is important. Because if you don't get them into a routine here, then in another 2 years, they'll go into the stormy phase and you will have great difficulty managing that because their entire biological rhythm changes at that point. So you have to get them into a routine here. And today, a lot of parents want to be cool moms and dads. I think kids actually need limits. This is where you need to find a sweet spot between not being too permissive, not being too strict. See, it is only when you set limits that they feel psychologically secure. It gives them a sense of security. And when you set limits, they also learn to tolerate frustration or to manage themselves. And your no should always be a no. Don't make a no into a yes. That means before you say no, you have to think about why you're saying it. You're very certain as to why you're saying no. So let that no remain no and don't turn that into a yes. Why? Because it gives them a sense of consistency and also stability. And it's very important for children to operate from that space of consistency and stability. Of course, fathers do matter. Because generally when we talk about parenting, we think that it is the mother's responsibility, but it's important that fathers also get involved because for the girls, it's their first encounter that they have with a man. And for the boys, the father is the first hero. And we find that when fathers get involved in the girls' lives, they have a better picture of what a man is like. And boys get into less trouble in school when fathers connect with them. It is very, very important. It's nice to see fathers attending parent-teachers meeting, fathers being a part of their lives because both father and mother are important. Fathers give a different perspective to life. Mothers give a different perspective to life. And a combination of these two are necessary. Even when it comes to technology also, technology when it is used for the right purpose, it's fine, but otherwise it can become a nightmare. And especially now that children are so used to having this technology in their hands, it is so important that you have some kind of a screen time. And that means if the rules are set for children, the rules apply for the parents too. So parents and children both have to obey these rules, the screen time rules. So make sure that in a day, there is a time when the entire family is not using technology at all, but then you're just spending a little time with each other, maybe playing some kind of a game or probably, doing some kind of gardening or some kind of activity, but then it's a screen-free time. And that's important. And finally, I would say, it's important for us to stay calm, decode the behavior of your children, meet this need to connect. And when you connect with empathy, because with that, we can leave behind beautiful memories for our children. Thank you. If you have any questions, I can take the questions now.
Thank you, Ma, for the wonderful information that you have shared with us. I'm sure that your valuable insights will help us connect with the children and guide them to make the most of their potential. Dear parents, it is now time to clarify your doubts with Dr. Shalini Ayyappa. You may type your questions in the chat box, and those who are unable to use the chat box may use the raise hand option and your mics will be enabled. I request Ms. Deepthi to moderate the interactive session.
Good evening, everyone. After the wonderful session, I think we have a lot of queries in our with us. Dr. Shalini Ayyappa would address the questions. So we'll be now the chat box is turned on. If you have any queries, please type it on the chat boxes. And if you are unable to type, please raise your hands. We will unmute you. Please raise your hands. I have one person raising the hand. Yeah. I think parent of Jaden Lobo, you can unmute. 1 minute, ma'am. You can unmute and speak.
Ma'am, I'm Jaden Lobo's mother. As you were talking about this setting up screen time and connecting with the children. I have a son who's in fourth. And when sometimes it's between these classes that I sit behind him to see what he is, because he takes time to understand things and all. And there's sometimes confusion in the class. So I tell him, do this, ask him so that you get clarified. But he doesn't understand that concept. And then he comes to me and asks. So because I have no knowledge about the new this. So how do we... Now, when I connect with him, say, do this as what my knowledge is, he reacts to it in a different way. He says, no, it is this, that, and that.
I think you have to see, probably what you are doing is you're telling him, you're giving him a direction, or you're telling him that, no, you need to do it this way. Why don't you ask him, I mean, how would you like to do it? Or is there any other way of doing it? See, the minute you ask this question, you actually kind of get into a conversation. Especially when it comes to technology, please remember that we have to kind of keep pace with the changing times. That's very, very important, and for all parents. Children may know something more about technology than us. So it'll be nice if we can just get them into a conversation so that we know how much they know. And if we don't know something, we also get to know, because they definitely feel very happy teaching us certain things. So maybe in your case, when you tell him that this is what needs to be done, this is how it should be done, you know, the should and must, he doesn't like it. But instead, you get him to your style of questioning should be, I mean, how exactly do you think you can do it? Is there any other way of doing it? Then he will explain to you how it can be done.
Thing is, I usually take the initiative, because he hardly takes the initiative. He's a little distracted in class. So when I say, okay, listen, he listens and tells me, okay, this has been done. But I said, you should even focus on other things also, not on one particular thing. But that is a little less on his part.
No, I didn't get you. I mean, what exactly is the issue with your child now?
For example, one is that. And second thing is, now he loves a particular subject, one subject, and he would love to do it 24 hours. Even if you give him more time, he'll do it. But when I said, come on, let's change the direction and do something else, like any activity, then he's not interested in it. He'll do it by as though it's a force. Then I motivate him. See, I said, this is there, you can do this. Now, now lately, because of this lockdown process, I bought many things to deviate his mind. But he does it very excitingly, but then he leaves the whole thing there down.
can you get him to kind of prepare a schedule? Can he decide like what he would like to study at what time and for how long he would like to spend time on each subject? So even if he kind of spends maybe say 1 hour on one subject and the subject which doesn't interest him so much, he spends say about half an hour, still it is okay. Even that half an hour is still okay.
He doesn't take that. I mean, he's now, as you said, their children are technology this and their screen time is this. So the screen time comes in between. Now, after his class, I tell him to take rest. As you said, they require good sleep.
Yes.
But he doesn't want to sleep. He wants to...
What does he do?
He sometimes either reads books or get into some maths thing because maths is his favorite subject.
No, and that is fine. I don't see any problem in this child because when I said screen time, what I meant is if the child is all the time on the phone...
No.
Now, your child is not all the time on the phone. And when you say that your child reads books, I think that's wonderful.
No, because we hide our phones. We hide our phones.
You hide your phone.
Yeah.
So he has no access to it.
No. If he gets access, then he'll spend the whole time.
Pardon?
If he gets access to the phones and TVs and all, he uses the whole time.
Yeah, but then you have set limits there, right? So he has no access to the television or the phone, but he's forced to read a book or maybe spend little time doing his math because which he likes it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think you are in the right direction. That's perfectly fine. And that amount of that much of monitoring is definitely necessary.
Yeah.
So you have found your way of making sure that the child has no access to the phone or technology for a while so that the child spends... his time doing something constructive. That's wonderful.
But study time is not there. That's what.
Study time you have to set.
Oh.
He will not set. He is not in an age where he will just say that, okay, these are my goals in life and I just need to achieve this goal. So I need to spend a lot of time doing my studies. Of course, he will not do it. You have to set aside that time. And during that study time, it's very important that the parent is also present there.
Okay, thank you.
Parent of Sean D'Souza, yeah, you can speak.
Hello.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Yeah, your session was very nice and some of the points which I really wanted. There's some things which actually I'm not doing it and because of this session, I understood how to handle these siblings. One main question which I have is regarding the screen time. Like I have a small one of 3 years and he's of 8 years. How to handle them? Like she needs the TV sometimes to watch some of her cartoons and this one is always like, why are you favoring her? Why are you telling me to study? Or why are you keeping me busy always? Why you are liking her? Why you are with her always? Even though I am, giving time to this boy, still I have these questions.
See, one thing is, if how old did you say is your younger child?
She's of 2 years, 2.5 years.
2.5 years. And you feel that a 2.5-year-old child has to watch some of the programs on television?
No. Sometimes it's like when we sit, like Peppa Pigs or something like that. Like in between, I just give her to watch.
See, what is important here is if it is a screen time, if it's a program that something which your older child and your younger child can watch, I think all of you can watch that program together because even your older child is not that old to watch some other program. Definitely the programs that she watches would also be kind of be interesting to your younger one who's just about 2.5.
Yeah, but what
so why not make a time where all of you watch that program so that the older one doesn't feel that, the programs that you allow the younger one to watch and denying the older one to watch. I think that comparison will not come.
Sometimes what happens to make him to sit for the online classes, when I'm TV. I just make her to sit in front of the TV at least for some time.
Oh, and okay. It is. Yeah. It's kind of, you don't have anybody else to manage the younger one?
Yeah, that is an issue.
Can't you get the younger one also to be there when the older one is sitting for a class?
Sometimes she sits. Even I tried that. But the thing is, like, she disturbs him a lot.
Yeah, but this is not a regular thing.
Okay.
I think you have to tell, see, you have to dialogue with your older child and tell the child that it's only for this reason sometimes that I have to just get her to be in front of the screen. But otherwise, if you can, instead of focusing on that, if you can just find a time where all three of you sit together and watch a program which your older child likes, there is no room for comparison at all. Then what will happen is, then you can tell the child that, see, sometimes when you have to log into the class, she may become very troublesome here. So I need to just put her in front of the television, and then you just switch it off once, you know, the child logs into the class and the child is in an online class.
Okay.
Some small little changes here and there.
Yeah, that's true.
And a little bit of comparison definitely will be there because there is a kind of a gap here.
Yeah, correct.
But you have to consciously make sure that you also spend time with the older child, especially talking to the child because she is now in her growing years. So it's important that you set aside some time for your older child. Maybe when your husband comes back home from work, if the younger one can be under his care for a while and you spend a little time with the older child, then the older child will not feel that, you know, you're not spending enough time with her.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, thank you, ma'am.
Okay, we will move with the next parent. I think parent of Anisha.
When it comes to sleep, remember, switch off all your technology and phones. The house kind of has to go into that sleep ritual where you have to quieten the place, make sure that the lights are not too bright. Even if you're playing some kind of music, let the music not be the bang bang kind of music, which will excite the child. And I think it's important that even if you are in the habit of watching television or there is a program at that time, I think all these things should just go off at that time. If you put your children to sleep, say around 8:39, then definitely they can wake up in the morning, early in the morning, but not otherwise, because they need about 9 to 10 hours of sleep. So if your child is, if you are saying that your child cannot watch this, then parents also cannot watch it. The rule is the same for all. Because otherwise the children can't have different rules and you can't have different rules when it comes to the use of technology.
And parent of Anisha, please ask your question.
Yeah, good evening, ma'am. I would like to ask, my daughter is lazy in writing. How to make her write? In the school, it was like, when it was offline, our teacher used to work hard with so many kids, but we are not able to write with our kids. We cannot able to make them write. I feel so difficult, like making them to submit assignments on time. So what is, like, how we can do it with making them write everything on time and submitting on time?
Now, I don't know, because I really need to find out. When you say that your child is very lazy in writing, is a child lazy or is it that there is too much of writing that the child has to do? And the writing is by looking at the screen and copying something from there. Definitely, it's going to be very tiring for the child. And if this is something that you are finding out now, during the pandemic, with the online classes are tiring for the children. And if they have to copy something from the screen, it is even more tiring. Let us understand that.
Yes.
So you need to find out how much the child is able to write in a day. And let the child write only so much in that day, on that day. Okay. It's not just for children, even for us, if we have to look at the screen and write something, it's very, very tiring because our bodies and brains are not designed for that.
Yes. It is
so real. Find out how much your child can write every day. Yes. And identify the time of the day also when the child is in a mood to write. Identify that time and make sure that the child does the writing during that time.
Yes. Since I'm a working parent, it is very difficult.
Yes. But there's nobody to monitor the child back home.
No, nobody will be there. Like your sister is there, but she has her own classes till evenings. So it's very difficult.
Now I understand with the pandemic and lockdown and for working parents, and if you're not at home, it's really hard. It's very hard. There is no magic here.
Yes. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your words.
Dear parents, we will be addressing another two questions. And if you still have any queries, we will share our resource person's contact details. You can contact her, or even you can post your questions in the school app also. Last two questions we'll be taking. Parent of Mark Norona.
Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening.
Ma'am, as you mentioned, kids this age are relatively easy to handle, right? But they don't have any outwardly signs of bigger issues like depression, etc. But do you think the pandemic, not being able to go to school, not being able to interact with other children, could lead to certain issues in later years? Is there something
not
that we as
because they are
parents
children,
would need to watch out for?
It can be compensated because, of course, it is going to have an impact on their mental health, as in constantly just being confined to their homes and the interaction with the other children is not their interaction with the teachers, going to school, because it's a whole lot of experience going to school. And especially if it's a single child, then there is nobody else unless the parents are there to spend some time with the child, or in the neighborhood there are some children. Definitely it is going to have an impact, but I don't see that the pandemic is going to be forever. I'm a little hopeful that it'll be over soon and our children will get back to school. But definitely it'll have an impact because that socio-emotional connection with the school, the teachers, the friends, the interaction with the friends, this is very, very important for them because this is where they learn a lot of skills too. Sometimes they agree with their friends, sometimes they disagree with their friends, they learn to negotiate, they come to a consensus. Now all this happens through friendship and the interaction that they have with their friends. So that is something that is lacking. So it can have an impact on them. And especially children who are shy can go into a shell because it's an advantage to them to hide behind the screen now because it's online classes.
Any telltale signs to watch out for, ma'am?
Pardon?
Any signs to watch out for, especially for the ones on the cusp of teen?
See, look for signs like, is the child kind of isolating herself? And if the child has kind of gone silent and is not really kind of talking much, then it's important that you just sit down with the child and have a casual conversation. Make it a point to have these casual conversations with your children every day. It need not be about not just about why is that you're not talking. Instead, you can say that, are you feeling okay? Or if you're feeling a little low, you can tell the child I'm feeling a little low today, maybe because it is raining. See, this is how you start a conversation. So slowly the child also feel it is okay to express these feelings. See, it's only when you express certain things, they also learn to express. So you have to make that space for them.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. And we'll even if the child is spending too much time on technology also, you need to keep a watch over that. It's very, very important.
Thank you, ma'am. We'll be taking the last question. That will be the parent of Anora Mendonza. Please unmute and speak.
Very interactive session. My question is again as to what was spoken previously in the previous concern. Now, with the online classes that are happening, the peer-to-peer interaction between the children has gone. I mean, there's no peer-to-peer interaction between the children. Also, I mean, what I found is, I mean, my children barely know who their classmates are. So how can this be increased? I mean, can there be a way wherein the children are made to talk to each other so that they get into that spirit of friendship once again, you know, because it's been missing, I think, over the past period of 2 years. Especially since my child, I mean, we've just come in last year, you know, moved into the school for last year, so they haven't met anybody. And it's been more towards academics rather than, you know, a little bit of peer-to-peer interaction would be very nice, I think.
Yeah, definitely that peer interaction is very important. And I think the school can kind of create this platform by having some kind of activities where children can interact with each other. I think the school should take this initiative because this peer interaction definitely, like you said, is very much needed. And since you've just moved in and probably it started with all this pandemic, I don't think the children even know any of their classmates. I guess the school or the class teacher can kind of have some kind of an activity, even if it is on the virtual platform, where the children can kind of interact with each other. I guess the school should take that initiative.
Thank you, ma'am. I think more so because when there is the teacher in the class who is monitoring the child, they are less prone to express themselves with their friends. I mean, usually there would be a banter in the school when the child goes to school during the offline mode. They do have the banter between themselves. They talk to each other. They get to know their hobbies, various things that are spoken. So probably, you know, a session where let the children spend some time with each other in a session, you know, a little bit of time once a week or so that they get to know each other well. I mean, a lot of things can be discussed and it would move them. Maybe they would feel happier to attend class, you know, a certain session. He does this.
Yes, I think this kind of interaction is very much needed and school can actually take this initiative. Even on a virtual platform also, the teacher probably can start have a kind of an activity, a kind of an ice-breaking activity, and then just allow the children to kind of, interact with each other. Maybe the teacher can think of some kind of, a kind of a question. It could be related to anything which the children can kind of communicate with each other. And I guess allow the children to kind of communicate there. I guess the school should take this initiative and do that. And I think as a parent, you could suggest this to the school, because otherwise what happens is the newcomers definitely, like you said, may not know their peer group at all and they may feel isolated and left out.
Done. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.
Parent of Neil Basu. Ma'am, you can unmute and speak. Parent of Neil Basu.
Yeah, my name is Amlyn, and I would like to address the previous question. I have been trying to help my child in Hindi and also another parent's child in Kannada. So since I'm good in Kannada, what I did is I started the team using the Teams software itself, and I made a session with the other child, and so we can interact and teach each other's children, you know, the said subject. So this is a very good platform, the Teams, to, since we all know the contacts of all other children in the Teams software, it becomes very easy to coordinate different activities. Even parents can do that. Since I have done it myself, I know it works. Thank you.
Yeah, maybe for that, the parents also kind of need to know each other.
That will help for the initially, that will help, but we can conduct activities through the help of a teacher, and parent also can do that. If a teacher is stressed with other subjects, a parent also can do some activities if they are free. Yeah,
I think what the school can do is find out like in what way the parents can kind of contribute and you know, supporting the academics of the children. And I think based on that, the parents can kind of interact with each other and see if the children can also have this interaction at the same time.
That's true, yeah.
Yeah.
In my childhood, group activity always helped me learn. So that is why I tried this initiative.
No, that's wonderful. That's a real nice initiative.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am, for answering all the questions. I request Lavina, ma'am, to take over. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. It is not the joy that makes us grateful. It is the gratitude that makes us joyful. I request Ms. Vijayalakshmi to deliver the vote of thanks.
Gratitude is the fairest blossom which springs from the soul. Good evening to all. On behalf of St. Aloysius Gonzaga School, I deem it a great honor and privilege to propose the vote of thanks on this occasion of the parent-teachers meeting. At the outset, I would like to thank our chief guest and resource person, Dr. Shalini Ayappa. Ma'am, we are enlightened by your knowledge and presence. I am sure that the parents have taken note of your suggestions. Thank you, ma'am.
You're welcome.
I would like to express our profound gratitude to our principal, Reverend Father Melvin Anil Lobo SJ, for his moral support and guidance. Thank you, Father. I'm happy to express my thanks to our Vice Principal, Ms. Laurel D'Souza, and all the teaching staff for their unflinching support and coordination. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, teachers.
Thank you, teachers.
As Mahatma Gandhi said, every home is a university and the parents are the teachers. Our sincere gratitude goes to all parents who made the effort to attend this online meeting with teachers to support your ward's progress and the work of the school. Thank you, dear parents. Once again, I thank you all for attending this meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your words of gratitude. Challenges are ahead, nurturers are behind, tending to create a beautiful garden where buds and blossoms bloom. We bid adieu with the affirmation that today's success is the beginning of tomorrow's achievement. Thank you, one and all.